Well, good evening, and let's, before we get to the word and open it together, let's do the best thing that we can and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you. It is a light for our path. And Father, we thank you for the way that it feeds our souls, ministering to us in the best of times and in times where we feel uncertain and worried and confused. And Father, as we look into one particular portion of your word together, would you help us to understand? Would you help us to think well about your word? But more than that, Father, by your Spirit, would you minister to our hearts where we are? Would you open up our eyes and reveal more about yourself to us? And would you bid our anxious souls to find quiet and rest and shelter in the sure and certain knowledge of who you are and what you are doing even in our days. So, Father, open your word for us, we ask. Help us in our weakness to understand it and to lay hold upon it by your strengthening. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. I'd like to read to you a few verses from 1 Peter. And this is 1 Peter chapter 1. And it's just the first two verses. And I'll explain why we're in 1 Peter in just a moment. So this is 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. So why have we added an extra portion of Bible teaching at this time and in this format? The answer is quite simple. One of the joys of the people of God in ages past and even in times present is that when we turn to the Word of God, what we find for our souls and for our well-being is joy and comfort that the Word of God, the promises of God offer to us. Even in the darkest of moments, the Word of God has throughout the ages proven to be such a place of refuge and shelter for the people of God. Right now, we are in a lockdown, whatever the technical term is, but that's what it seems to be. And many people, Christians included, find themselves anxious and worried and fearful about what that may look like in coming days, weeks, maybe even months. So when we turn to the Word of God, what we realize is the Word of God is applicable to every single situation that we find ourselves in the course of our lives. This one being no different. It has something to say to us. My job as a Bible teacher, a preacher, is very simply to take the appropriate portions of the Word of God and apply them to the lives of those that God has entrusted into my care at the most appropriate moment. So it's finding the right medicine for our souls and applying it to us at just the right time. That's the calling that God has placed upon my life for the good of us, the church. So what I want to do with you is to study an appropriate portion of the Word of God for a time just like this, recognizing that it's His voice that we need to hear. It would be so easy for us to spend our days simply sitting in front of our screens, whichever format that comes in, and to listen to daily news feeds or to politicians updating us on where we are. And there's nothing wrong with that. But if that is all that we are feeding our souls with, that is not a means of grace or comfort or hope. The means of grace that we have is the Word of God. So what we're going to do together is to delve into the Word of God to see if His voice will bring to us grace and peace that can strengthen us in times just like these. So why do I think that 1 Peter is an appropriate portion of the Bible for us to study at this time? Well, the fascinating thing about it is we read, first of all, that it was written by Peter, who's an apostle of Jesus Christ, but it's who it's written to and the condition that they find themselves in. Listen to what it says. To those who are elect exiles of the dispersion, the literal word there being diaspora, those who were dispersed, those who were unable to gather together, these are the dispersed ones. Now, we're told equally that they are all over the place. There's some who are in Pontus, there's some who are in Galatia, there's some who are in Cappadocia, there's some in Asia, there's some in Bithynia. So they're all over the place. He's writing to a group of people who are dispersed. They're not able to gather together anymore. Rather, they are dispersed and they are all over the place. Now, this is one of two letters in the New Testament that is specifically written to people who are dispersed, to people who maybe once were gathered together and now that's just not a possibility anymore. They're dispersed. This is one of two letters written specifically for people who were designated as the diaspora. And what I'll do is I'll let you try and figure out what the other one is, if you don't already know the other letter is that was written to these dispersed ones who are all over the place. Now, in 1 Peter, we're not 100% sure why they were dispersed. Well, we get some ideas and people have made some suggestions. But what we do know is this, and this is at the other end of 1 Peter in chapter 5 and verse 9, where it says this: resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. So we don't know exactly why they were dispersed, but what we do know is in their dispersion, the one thing that seemed to be common to them was that they were suffering. This was not a dispersion for them that was really pleasing. It was a dispersion in which they, and indeed all their brothers, were suffering together. So if you join the dots just with the opening verse of this letter and the closing part of this letter, why is it so appropriate? Well, right now we are dispersed. We are unable to gather together. We're unable to be together. And when you think about it, we are literally all over the place. There's some who are dispersed to Balloch, to their homes there. There's others of us who are in Culloden. There's others in Smithton or West Hill. There's some on the other side of Inverness. There's some out in Tornegrain or Nairn. There's some of us who are dispersed over to the Black Isle or over in Conton. We're dispersed all over the place. We even have people who are now joining into our times of ministry together like this from way down in England. There's people from across the pond who are joining in our studies together. We're all over the place. And the thing that we have in common is we're dispersed. But unlike 1 Peter, we know the reason for our dispersion. We know that it's because of COVID-19 that we've been locked down to our homes and limited to going out except under certain situations. We know that our government is trying their very best to stop the NHS being overwhelmed. So unlike 1 Peter, we know why we're dispersed. They would have known why they were dispersed. We're not certain, but they were. We do know why we've been dispersed. And like them, already some of our number are struggling with the suffering that's endured. And thinking about it in the days and weeks ahead, more of us are going to share in that suffering because of the situation that we find ourselves in right now. And here we have this letter given to us like the Word of God. And the purpose behind the Scriptures is to equip us, the people of God, for every situation that we find ourselves in. So we have this letter that's specifically written for people like us in the situations that we find ourselves in. And what it's doing is it's going to explain a variety of different things. Most importantly, and the very first thing it does is it reminds us about who God is. So important that we remember that in a situation like this. It goes on to explain how we're supposed to behave as the people of God in a situation like this. It teases out exactly what that means for us in our lives. It speaks about how we're supposed to relate to our governments as they're trying to care for us and protect us and lead our country. It explains how we're supposed to behave within our own homes. Now think about it. For some of us, we are locked into our homes with other people for at least 3 weeks. I think we genuinely need the wisdom of God and how to relate to one another so that we all come back out of our houses in 3 weeks. It tells us how we relate to the world and what the world can rightly expect from us. And it teaches us, this letter, how we're to learn to care and love and serve for our church family, how we learn to care for one another. It also speaks honestly about suffering. It deals with it head on and explains some of the reasons that God has for suffering. Not all of them, but some of them. So this letter is gifted to us to equip us and prepare us for moments like these. And equally in 1 Peter 5, it gives me as a pastor of this church a very, very specific command. Where Peter says this, I exhort the elders among you. I'm one of four elders in this church. And here is Peter saying, I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed, shepherd the flock of God. So here I have Peter in this letter, written for people like us in a situation like we're in, commanding me to shepherd the flock of God, to feed the flock. Hence why we've got this extra teaching that'll be going on each week. Now, my hope is that we're going to cover the entirety of 1 Peter in 12 weeks. Now, for some people, that might seem a very, very long time to get through a letter. For us, in this church, it'll be a minor miracle if I get through this letter in 12 weeks, but we're going to give it a go and see how we get on. The very first thing that we need to see, and it is so important that we do, is that in this letter, the very first thing that Peter does after he's introduced himself and after he's made it clear who he's speaking to in the situation that they find themselves in, the very first thing that he does, he reminds us of who's in control of all things. The very first person that he wishes to speak about is God. What he makes clear, now pay careful attention to the words. He says this, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion. And he explains all the different places they are in Pontus and Galatia and Cappadocia, Asia and Bithynia. Now listen to what he says. According to the foreknowledge of God. We need to fill in a bit of the broader picture here. Peter has introduced himself as an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now, here's something that you need to understand. It can be a little bit difficult to grasp at times, and some people don't like to think upon it too much. But trust me, it brings so much comfort to your heart and your soul if you can just grasp this. Peter did not choose to follow Jesus Christ. Peter did not choose to become an apostle of Jesus Christ. Here's how we need to think about this. Jesus chose Peter. Jesus chose and appointed Peter to be an apostle. Jesus did the choosing. Let me show you this in a gospel called Mark's Gospel, which whilst Mark's name hangs over the gospel, what I firmly believe is that Peter stood behind this gospel, kind of instructing Mark and telling him, this is what happened, this is how it happened, this is who is involved. So Peter is kind of the one narrating Mark's gospel, but Mark's writing it out. That's what I think about Mark's gospel. So in Mark chapter 3 and verse 13, listen to this. And he went up on the mountain and called to him those whom he desired. That's Jesus. He went up on the mountain and called to him those whom he desired, and they came to him. And he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him, and he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. He appointed the 12. Now he lists them. The very first one listed is this: Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter. So the person who chose Peter to be an apostle was not Peter, it was Jesus himself. Jesus chose and appointed Peter to be an apostle. So the primary one in salvation, the primary worker is not me or you, it's actually Jesus. Jesus does the calling and Jesus does the appointing. In the same way that God is primary in our salvation, that's not saying that we don't have a willful response to it. We do. We accept the gift of salvation. But God is primary in these things. And in the same way that God is primary in salvation, in choosing and electing people, he's also sovereign in everything that happens in our lives. God foreknew those who were to be elected. He also foreknew the conditions that they would find themselves in. Listen how it reads. To those who are the elect exiles of the dispersion, according to the foreknowledge of God. God knew who he was going to choose. He also knew the situation that they would find themselves in. Peter does not have this idea of God. He's like, he's there in heaven, and he's gathered his elect, his church before him, and they're all gathered. And then he like gets distracted by this angelic envoy, and the envoy's having a conversation with God. And then he turns back, and oh my goodness, the church is gone. What has happened? That is not Peter's understanding of God. God is sovereign over all things. He was sovereign in calling you, Christian. He chose you before ever you chose him. And he's sovereign in the various situations that unfold in your life. He even explained to Peter, this is Jesus, the death he was going to die. One of the conversations that he has with Peter, whom he chose, goes like this. He commands Peter to do what Peter in 1 Peter 5 commands me to do. Jesus says to Peter, feed my sheep. He goes on to say this to him, truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go. This he said to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. God is sovereign in all things. He was sovereign in choosing and appointing Peter. He was sovereign in the different things that happened in Peter's life. And he even explained to him long before it happened how he was going to die. Now, Christian, God was sovereign in choosing you, in calling you, in making you one of his elect sojourners on the earth right now, which means this whole lockdown, it's not like it took your Father in heaven by surprise. It was foreknown to him. It's news to us, but it was foreknown to him. The dispersion that we are in right now, God has known about it even before he even called you. And he also has a plan in this to be worked out in your life. And that brings us on to this next little phrase where it says, according to the foreknowledge of God, in the sanctification of the Spirit. Now, sanctification, it sounds like a very academic or involved word, and it really is a beautiful word. But what this phrase is talking about, it's actually quite simple. It's not that complicated. In the midst of this situation, and in calling you and foreknowing you and electing you, God has a plan that the Spirit is going to work in your life in such a fashion that the whole idea of being sanctified is that the Spirit makes you more and more like Jesus Christ. It's that simple. I used to be a gardener handyman in an old folks' home, a care home up in Caithness. And my job involved two things, handyman stuff and gardening stuff. Half of my job I was good at, half it was just a train wreck. And that became very apparent when I went to one of the flower beds and decided I would do something to make stuff grow. The end result was everything died. And what we figured out was I was a horrendous gardener, and the one thing I could grow was weeds. But within the care home, there was a bunch of older folk who had been and were phenomenal gardeners. So they had the ideas and the brains on how to grow things, and I had the strength to do what they told me. So we worked in this together. My ideas, train wreck. Their understanding, things could actually grow. Now, here's what we need to understand. The one person who is able to grow you and me more and more into the image of Jesus Christ, it is neither me nor you. It is the person of the Holy Spirit. He is phenomenal at growing us more and more into the likeness of Jesus Christ. He knows the exact setting that we need to be in right now, according to the plans of God, that we might flourish and grow more and more into the image of Jesus Christ. Do you understand what that means? That the Spirit is working in this situation right here and now, even in our lockdowns, to do one thing, to make you more like Jesus Christ. It moves on to this next point here, which it's a beautiful image, but I'm going to have to help you see it a little bit in the same way I had to work at this to figure out what exactly does this bit mean. So God knew this was all going to happen, and it's part of his plan, and the Spirit is working in this and through this to make me more like Jesus. Okay, I get that, but it's this next bit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood. Peter has this image in his mind here, which once you see it, it really is just beautiful. It's great. So let me take you way back into the Old Testament when the people of God have just built the temple. So it's finally all finished, and the temple has been built, and all the different parts of the temple are now within it, the furniture and everything else. It's all in the temple. And you can read about this way back in the Old Testament. And what you read about them doing is at that point, they consecrate it to God. It's given over to God. They've built it and everything else, and then it's just given over to God. And the way that they do this consecrating is it's sprinkled with blood, and then from that point on, it's given over to God. The whole idea behind the temple from that point forward is, well, it belonged to God. It was his. And everything that was going to happen within the temple grounds, it was all for one purpose, for the glory of God. So it was built for God, given over to God, sprinkled with the blood, and from that point on, it was consecrated. It was set apart for the glory of God. Now, what Peter is saying here about you, Christian, is as you have come in repentance and faith to God, trusting that Christ has done everything necessary to reconcile you to God, the blood of Christ has been applied to your life, and that means that we have forgiveness and all the blessings of the new covenant, it also means you have been consecrated and set apart for God. Where you are right now in the situations that you find yourself. So put all that together, and here's the plan of God for you in your dispersion. See, I've been in churches long enough now to have people say, you know, when I come up with a great new idea or a new plan, and people will say, yeah, we did that 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 50 years ago. We tried that, and these are the results we had. Or people will say that the church goes through seasons, and we don't really experience anything new or completely different than previous times in the church. Well, I think right now it's fair to say we are in pretty uncharted territory for our generation. This type of thing has never happened to most of us before. And what we're trying to figure out is how do we live out our faith in times like these? Well, the plan and the purpose of God is clear. God the Father has chosen you, Christian, to be sojourning on the earth at a time like this. The situation we're in has not taken God by surprise. In actual fact, it's all part of his plan. Now, it's not a plan I don't think any of us would have chosen, but how often is that true with the way that God works in our lives? The times that we will have seen most significant growth as believers, they're never ways that we would have chosen in which to grow. The situation that we find ourselves in, therefore, fits perfectly well in the kind of mold of the way that God works in our lives. And the Spirit, therefore, wants to use this to make us more and more like Jesus Christ, to conform us more to his image. And by the blood of Christ, we have been set apart and consecrated for this very purpose. His plan and his purpose right now is for you to be a woman or a man of God. And what he's going to explain in this letter is exactly what that's supposed to look like. He's going to explain how we're supposed to, like I've said, relate even to the government and not critique and criticize them, but rather to seek to pray for them and honor them. He's going to explain suffering for us and how we are to be and behave in the midst of it as people who've been set apart for Jesus Christ. This is an exciting time, but if we're honest, it's also scary. It's daunting. It's worrying. There's already people within our church who are just, their hearts are and have broken because they simply cannot embrace others whom they would love to embrace. They cannot be there for people who they want to be there for. So it's an exciting time as we're trying to figure out how we move forward from this, and we haven't been this way before. But it's heartbreaking and scary. No wonder then that this letter actually begins with a prayer. A prayer for the dispersed. A prayer that sums up pretty much everything that they need. It's a prayer that you can memorize in this time of our dispersion. And an easy one to recite. Whatever you're doing in the midst of your day, here's something you can memorize and just use it to pray. Listen to how Peter prays for his dispersed flock. He prays like this. This is the end of verse 2. He says this: may grace and peace be multiplied to you. See, in our anxiety and in our fear and our worry and our broken heartedness. The one thing that we need is peace. A peace that can guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. That is why Peter is praying that peace may be multiplied to you. A peace that comes from God and is rooted in God. A peace that will allow you, regardless of what may unfold in coming days and weeks and months, a peace that will reassure you, God has this. And Christian, he's holding you in his hand, using this as a means to grow you in more and more into the likeness of his son. But God has this. It's not a surprise to him. When we think about what's called from us at times like these to be conformed more to the likeness of Jesus Christ, I think my initial response is, I don't know if I have the strength for this. I don't know if I have the giftings for a situation like this, or, you know, I don't, maybe I could last a week, or maybe 2 weeks, or maybe 3 weeks. But you see, if this goes to like a month, I'm not sure if I have the strength for that, or 2 months, or 3 months. What's being made clear in this letter is, Christian, you don't. I don't. The one thing that we need just to get through today is the grace of God. So as well as praying that peace may be multiplied to them, what he's praying here is, and may grace be multiplied to you. May the strength of God, the blessings of God, the giftings of God in Christ, may they simply be multiplied to you in a time like this, elect sojourner of God, when you are dispersed in a variety of different places. May his grace and his peace be multiplied to you. Let me pray for you as we bring this time to a close. Let's pray. Gracious Father, you know all things, you do all things well, and you are the God who saves. Father, even but a few weeks back, we thought upon that verse where you make it clear that our ways are not the same as your ways, and our plans are not the same as your plans. Father, we have a longing as your children to be more and more like Jesus Christ. And yet the way that we would do that, the means that we would use to grow ourselves, are, as we've just heard in that verse that I quoted, they're not the same plans that you have. They're not, your ways are not ours. Your thoughts not the same as our thoughts. Indeed, Father, you make it clear, as high as the heavens are above the earth, such is the difference between them. Father, in times like these, I pray for your church, your children, and I would pick up this prayer of Peter. Father, may indeed your peace be multiplied to us. Father, where hearts are anxious and worried and broken, may your peace descend upon them like the morning dew, saturating everything and leaving nothing untouched. Father, where the distance between loved ones is already being felt, where tears are falling, Father, may you, through the Spirit, minister in those moments for the glory of Jesus Christ, we ask. Give a peace which goes beyond human understanding. In Jesus' name, we pray. And Father, we know in your word that you tell us you will give us grace for today, as this day will contain enough troubles of its own. Father, I pray for your church as we learn what it means to be dispersed, as we feel the reality that the recipients of this letter were living in. Father, may your grace, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father, multiply it to us in the differing ways that we need it. Father, for those who are literally all alone at home at times like these, Father, please visit these ones with your presence. We recognize you are limited by nothing and no one. May they begin to enjoy times with you that they've never enjoyed before, all on account of your grace and your tender mercy and love. Father, for couples in times like these with the extra stress that is placed upon their relationships, Father, give grace. Allow love and kindness to be known and experienced among them. And Father, for family units locked in together in times like these, as parents learn to become teachers, Father, with all the different things that are going on in the different situations amongst the family units, Father, please guard them with your peace. And may these be times when relationships grow and are strengthened. May these be times when children's growth is seen so clearly before parents. And may these be times when children can enjoy the presence of their parents in their homes with them. Father, we pray against the evil one and the destruction that he would like to bring at times like these. And what we're asking instead, Father, is simply that the elect would grow, that your church would be built, all for the glory of Jesus Christ. Amen.